So guys, there's something a little bit special about today. Who's been paying attention? Who knows what's really special about today? Does anyone know? What's special about today, Logan? Yes! That's exactly right! It's the food! What's special about today? It's not just the food, but that's part of it. Yeah, the food!
You like the food too!
Riley, what else is special about today?
Morning service and night service come together.
Yeah! What are we calling that? What are we calling that? Celebration Sunday. Yeah, that's true. Yeah! What's special about today?
Play with your friends.
You get to play with your friends. Very soon you're going to get to go out, you're going to get to play with your friends. That's true. But it's our celebration service. Who knows what it means to celebrate? Celebrating is really awesome, isn't it? But what is celebration about? Who can tell me?
Parties.
Yeah, we're kind of partying. Yeah, that's true. What else? Who can elaborate on that? What is a celebration? What does it mean to celebrate?
Something special.
Yeah, we are doing something special today, aren't we? Yeah, we can have a birthday. It's sort of a birthday party today. Who knows how old our church is? How long have we been here? Of course you'll know that. All right, how old? Who can tell me how old is 25 years? Who can explain that? How big is 25? No. Oh, dude, Trudy's 25, so the church has been here as long as Trudy. That's a long time. Not as long as my age. Yeah, Logan?
Older than you?
No, it's not older than me. Thank you, though. Thank you that I look that young. That's nice of you.
Before we're born.
Yeah, before you guys are born, that's for sure. Who can show me 25 with your hands? So, that's a lot of hands, hey? Show me 25 with your hands. Can you show me 25 with your hands? Can you? Jeremy, go. All right, it's 25 years old. That's a good, I'm glad we've established that fact. That's really good. What do you guys love about this church? What's one thing that you love apart from the food? Because you guys like to demolish before the parents can get to it. What do you love about this church? Aren't they? We've heard lots about that. What do you love about the church? You like sitting up and sitting down? That's fun. That could be pretty fun. We've got those different things. The outfits? Yeah. You like the outfits of the people on stage? Great. Learning about God. Yes, that's great. We love learning about God and putting it into practice in our lives. Yeah, brother.
The takeover Sunday. I loved it. It was really cool.
You like being involved?
Yeah.
Yeah? Great, yes. The robots. Yeah.
The songs.
The songs? Anything else? Sunday school. Good job, Sunday school, kids' church guys. Sunday school is great. And what do you think the purpose of the church is? Why do we do this? Why do we come here each Sunday? What are we about? What are we trying to do as a church? Simeon?
Celebrate God.
Yeah, we come here to celebrate God. Yeah, yep, definitely. What are you bigger guys? What do we come here for? Yeah, learn about God. Good. We gather together to learn more about God. Anything else that we come here for? Yeah, we pray to Jesus and we pray for other people. That's true. Some of you other guys here, what do we come here for the church? What are we coming for each Sunday? Yeah. You don't know? But you love it. You love the food, you love the friends, that's really Great, guys. We have a lot to celebrate here, don't we? Ed, do you want to say something? Do you love our church?
Yeah.
I'm not telling you to say yes. All right. Guys, it's been a little bit of a long introduction, but you guys can go out now. So kids and the youth, junior youth church isn't on, so it's just kids. You guys will go out to your programs now, and we're going to get back to some praise and worship and continue to celebrate God.
We all carry scars, whether they're physical or emotional. But it's up to us as how we deal with it. Do we cling on to it and make it more than it should be, or is it in the past? And we can move on. Of course, Jesus had scars, and very precious scars they were. And his scars were for us. When he died on the cross, it's as if he, all our sin, all the wrong things we've done, was put on him. And that was horrible. Just horrible. He never had sin. And with that, my sin on him, the Father couldn't look at him. Makes me cry. And he did that for me. His love was so great that he was prepared for a time to be separated from God the Father. To go through that physical suffering was one thing, but I think that separation from his dad was something else. So we can reflect on that. But the best part is, and most importantly, is that when he died, he didn't stay there. It didn't defeat him, because otherwise it would have been in vain. He had to rise, and he could, because he is the Son of God. He is the Holy One. He is the Messiah. Oh, I don't like tearing up. So we can rejoice. We have the sadness of knowing that it was because of us, but the joy that his love was so great that he did it. Stand or sit, it's up to you. If you prefer to sit during these songs, entirely your choice.
By his stripes, we are healed. By his nail-pierced hands, we're free. By his blood, we're washed clean. Now we have the victory.
adore you, Lord. We adore you. We lift up our voices. We lift up our hearts to sing how great you are. How wonderful you are. How amazing you are. Lord, we've been praying for rain, so we thank you for it. Even though it changes our plans, Lord, we know that your plans are true and just. We know that your plans, your ways are better than our ways. So Lord, we thank you, Lord, for creation. We thank you for the world around us. We thank you, Lord, that you allow us to eat meat and the smell of it is so good. And we thank you, Lord, for the taste, smell, and touch. Thank you, Lord, for song that we can hear, the sound in our ears, the sight that we can see. Lord, we thank you for all that you give us. We know that everything good comes from you as a blessing. Learn from you, that you might grow us today, that we might go away from here growing more in you, more like you, more connected to you. We pray this in Jesus, in your holy name. Amen. 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 Please grab your seats. Today I'm going to be reading out of the book of Hebrews. And in Hebrews, we've got to move a little bit today. Because Godfrey is another church, the voice of the Lord Assembly. He comes and meets here at 12 o'clock. And so moving the service back to 10:30 and then not being out there, but being in here. So forgive me for being a little short, which you'll all be like, yeah, come on. Maybe we can do this every Sunday. Anyway, come on guys, let's not be judgmental towards the preacher. Hebrews 6, 16 to 20 says, this is from the Message version, when people make promises, they guarantee them by appeal to some authority above them. So if there's any question that they'll make good on the promise, the authority will back them up. When God wanted to guarantee his promises, he gave his word a rock-solid guarantee. God can't break his word. And because his word cannot change, the promise is likewise unchangeable. We who have run for our very lives to God have every reason to grab the promised hope with both hands and never let go. It is an unbreakable spiritual lifeline, reaching past all appearances right to the very presence of God, where Jesus, running ahead of us, has taken up his permanent post as a high priest for us. In the Bible, there are two places where the Bible speaks of an anchor. This is an anchor that is a lot different than the anchor 2,000 years ago that you know, the Bible authors were speaking about, but this is an anchor to a boat. And I think we understand that an anchor in a boat is what they throw out, into the water. And what? Why do they throw it out into the water? Any guesses? What do you think? So it stays. So it's snagged on something, it stays, and it holds the boat fast. So that's why you have an anchor on the boat. Now, there are two places where the Bible speaks about anchors. The first place is in the book of Acts. Acts 27, Paul is on a ship, and the ship is in a huge storm, and there's trouble there since land is getting close. And it says they throw out four anchors. They throw out four anchors to try to grab onto something on the bottom of the sea that can stop them from crashing against the land. The other place where this word anchor is used, it's used not in a physical sense, but as a metaphor. A metaphor for our lives. And just one verse from that, from the book of Hebrews, is from chapter 6, verse 19, it says, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. So it says, we have this hope is an anchor for the soul. Now we'll get on to what the hope is that's an anchor for our soul, but just go with me when you think about the soul. The soul is a part of our bodies. It's not actually our bodies at all, but it's more described as the spiritual us, the being of who we really are without the physical us. The part that will live on forever. It's the part of us that connects to God. It's our personality. It's who we are. It's the essence of truly us. And so our souls, when we think about them, when we think about an anchor for our souls, Whereas in life, our physical selves can kind of be beat up on occasion. Like physically we can go through hardships, but most of the time not physical kind of things happen to us. Yet when we think about our souls, I don't know about you, but I know for me, I can go from like the morning having a quiet time praying to God and really being close to God, and then something can happen to me in my day that just kind of like, well, maybe not like shakes my convictions, but it kind of makes me feel, man, I don't feel quite as close to God anymore. Or something can happen with my emotion through the day that I can feel really, really confident, feel really good. And something happens and it seems to kind of sweep our legs out from under us. Whether it be we're having a great time, that our kids are great, and then our kids start fighting, like, oh man, everything kind of falls apart. Or we're at work and the boss calls us in and we're like, oh, this is for a pat on the back, and then we end up fired. Or whether it's, you know, someone says something to us and it's like, oh, did he mean that or did he mean that? Was he meaning that for good or was that an insult? And we can kind of go from being great to kind of being down in the dumps, to being great again, to being down there. Our souls can be quite turbulent. I don't know if anyone's with me in that. I don't know if you feel that in your life, the kind of things can change much more on the inside than they do on the outside. We can kind of feel really terrible and down in the dumps very quickly on the inside, but on the outside we can show a face that looks like we're fine, that everything's going well. And so when this says we have a hope that's an anchor for the soul, we start to think, well that sounds like a good thing, because my soul can be turbulent, like a boat on the rocky, windy, wavy seas, like thrown around the place, but my soul has an anchor. There is something that I can anchor, connect my life to, that when I do that, when I put that down into this thing that is my hope, then I can be secure, firm. It can hold fast. So what is the anchor for our souls? Well, ultimately our anchor, our hope, is in Jesus. And the first passage I read out, which is the Message version, just kind of spoke about this hope being Jesus. But the interesting thing about anchors is that if I anchor myself to, who could I, Chris is not having any eye contact. Actually, let's get, okay, well, just an example, if you come and stand up with me. If I anchor myself to a person, to someone else, so that I can have my hope, so my soul can connect with another person, what can happen is, when I kind of feel really down in the dumps and I pull this way, if my anchor's not secure because it's just on a person, then that person can move along with me. Or if she has a really bad day and she starts pulling me in a different direction, then I can go along with her. So we don't want to anchor ourselves to something that isn't firm and secure, right? Excellent audience participation there. We don't want to anchor ourselves to something that isn't secure, right? Right, okay, so I'm going to secure my anchor to Jesus, and just for this, because you have a beard, Joel, you can look like Jesus, and so I can secure my anchor. That's not really secure, but that's better. Okay, so I can secure my anchor to Jesus, and then that's holding me, right? Because what happens with the anchor is, I'm on the top of the surface of the water. I'm kind of up here and being beaten around by the waves, but it's okay, because my anchor down the bottom, Jesus, at the bedrock of the ocean, he's secure. At the top of the waves are throwing everyone around, we're all moving around, our souls are moving with what's happening on the earth. But Jesus is down the bottom. And if you've ever seen a storm on the top and then you've gone 30 meters under the water, the water's calm, the water's normal, the storm doesn't affect him down, and that's where our bedrock is, that's where our anger, our hope lies. So I just want to give you four, because Paul, when he was looking not to get shipwrecked, they threw out four anchors. So I thought it would be good to have four anchors for us today to go through of our soul. The first one is that Jesus, when he was on earth, the interesting thing about Jesus was that he wasn't distant, but he was with us. Jesus came and lived amongst us, and because he lived amongst us, He can see all the things that we do. He's been with us. He's seen people who fail and seen people who live life. He knows how life is. So we have a God who can live amongst us, and he can see the things that we go through, and he can say, wow, I understand. I get that. Jesus was actually physically in a storm with his disciples, and they were on a boat, and it was all rocky, and the waves were throwing him around, and everything was pretty rough. And Jesus wasn't actually in the boat at this time. He was actually walking across the water, because he was Jesus, he could do that. And Peter, he sees Jesus, and it's like, you can see Jesus at the top of the wave, and they went down, he couldn't see Jesus, he sees Jesus. And so Peter's looking, and he's like, Jesus, I see you, Jesus, can I come out to you? And Jesus said, no, wait a minute, Peter, I'll just come onto your boat, it'll be much easier. No, he didn't. Jesus said, sure, come out to me. Because Peter looked and he saw an anchor. He saw the one that he wanted to cling onto in the midst of the storm. And so Peter started to walk out to Jesus. And as he was walking out to Jesus, he looked down and he saw the wind and the waves. He saw the waves moving, and he was like, oh, that's right, I'm a human being. Gravity has effect on me. And he started to sink. And Jesus pulled him up and he said, why do you doubt? I'm right here with you. And they jumped onto the boat, and it went calm. Jesus, even though he kind of questioned and said, why do you doubt? He also looked at Peter and he loved him, because he knew and he knows that we are not perfect. That our faith isn't always secure. That our souls go through highs and lows. And we need to anchor ourselves to someone far more secure. And so we can have that hope that Jesus is with us. And that's an anchor for our soul. But we know that in a boat, if you just throw out one anchor, what can happen is you can kind of be sitting in the middle of a beautiful estuary. You put an anchor in, fishing, or you have sleep. What can happen is the tide can move, right? And that one anchor that was really great, now it starts to go through. Or maybe you're going this way and you take out your child and your wife. And so we need more than one anchor. We still have the one hope, but the more anchors we can throw out to connect to that hope, the better chances that we'll be stable in the midst of the storm. So I thought, what's another anchor? Well, I can throw an anchor out this way. Ugh. Great. Good work. I knew you guys were watching, right? We were watching the whole time. Funny. So if you guys could secure that anchor somewhere, how are we going? Are we tied it off? Quickly around the leg, a few bodies, maybe a chair. It's getting better. It's good. Okay, that's almost great. So now I've got two points. Now the second point for our anchor that holds us in place in life is that we know that not only did Jesus come and live amongst us, but he actually came with a purpose so that he could go to the cross and die for us. Now that doesn't really mesh well in our culture. Because in our culture, we kind of don't really... A lot of people say, well, I didn't ask Jesus to die for me. Why did Jesus need to die for me? That's not important. That's not what I asked him to do. But actually, where this is important... Oh, my neck is pulled back. what's important is that we need to recognize that there's a reason why Jesus went to the cross for us. And I've done a couple of weddings recently. We've done pre-marriage counseling. And non-Christians, when you ask them if their partner is perfect or not, like this, they'll go, oh yeah, no, he is not perfect. She is definitely not perfect. Then you ask them, are you perfect? And they take a little bit longer, but they admit they're not perfect. So people who don't know Jesus, who haven't thought about this relationship they have with God, recognize that they are imperfect.